among the scores of plants he brought in 100 years ago to populate his expansive estate-sized property, Henry Huntington actively collected cycads, about as voraciously as his wife collected art. Cycads, the spiky fronded plants that look like palms but are more closely related to conifers, are highly prized by plant collectors for their slow growth and Jurassic-era beauty. But Huntington didn't likely know that his collection of plants would someday be valuable as scientific research. Today, scientists at the Huntington are studying cycad genetics, tracking the plant's evolution, and contributing to their conservation. Brian Dorsey, the Huntington's chief botanical researcher, also got a rare opportunity to study the plant's pollinators. Gary Roberson discovered some beetles, or specifically weevils, among some Dioon cycads.
Several years ago, Gary told me that he had found some beetles in the cones of an old cycad plant that we've had here for a long time.
Well, I put them in a bucket, and I contacted Brian, and I said, Brian, I've got something, you've got to take a look at this.
I had never seen the beetles, and I didn't know for sure that they were the pollinators. We just knew that they were there in the cones, and they might be.
And then we collected them and sent them off to Willie Tang in Florida, who identified them, and yes, they were the pollinators.
And so they might have been here from plants collected a long time ago, like by Henry Huntington, but we know that these cycads have obligate pollinators, so they rely on specific species of weevils. The pollinators, just like the Dioons, or the cycads, are native to Mexico, not here. So we would not expect to see them here at all. And the fact that they were here was really exciting because I'd never seen them before.
Well, that first sighting, we didn't see them for another 3 years. And then they showed up over here in the Dioon collection over here.
And that was surprising, but encouraging, because we thought they were gone. And we weren't sure why. The way the pollination works in cycads is that we already know that the cones produce attractant compounds, right? And that kind of signal to the beetles, this is the cone, and the beetles rely on the cones for their life cycle. That's where they lay their eggs, it's where their larvae eat. And so this set of attractant compounds pulls the beetles in.
So one plant's a male plant, one plant's a female plant. And they, you know, they are in populations so that the pollinating insects, beetles and weevils, would go between them.
I think so.
And this gave Brian a unique research opportunity to study how cycads attract these elusive pollinators.
But I'd like confirmation.
Irene Terry from the University of Utah has been doing this work for a number of years on different species, different genera actually, in Macrosamia and in Cycas, in Guam and surrounding islands, and also in Australia. So she's already got these techniques down. So we contacted her and said, look, we've got the beetles, they're in the garden, and you know the plants are coning all the time. Do you want to show us what you do? And maybe we could do the same work on Dioon, and then we'd have this comparable data. And she was all excited about it too. She flew out in like the next week and brought her equipment and showed us what she does.
The process Irene showed them involves a temperature probe being placed into a pollinating cone and attached to a data logger that records their temperature every few minutes, and every few days the data is uploaded and then used to determine when the pollinating cones are at their warmest, which is the best time to trap the volatile compounds emitting from them. To trap these compounds, a plastic bag is placed over the cone. The bag is cinched at the bottom around a tube that's connected to an air pump. At the end of the tube, the captured air passes through a pipette, which contains a powder that absorbs volatile compounds passing through it. Back at the lab, Brian elutes off the compounds by running solvent through the pipette, which drips into a small container that can then be sent off and analyzed through a mass spectrometer. And that's how you can determine the exact compounds being released.
It's important to point out that this is another example of the value of the collections here, of the botanical collections at the Huntington, and that this work is really difficult to do in the field. So to go to Mexico, to find the plants at the right time, to find the beetles, to do this long-term study, it's not impossible, but it's pretty hard. And speaking to entomologists that have tried to do it, that's one of the key problems, is just access to the plants at the right time and the ability to do these long-term studies. Like I've said, it's kind of a pilot study right now, learning the techniques. I think we're getting that down. We're pretty efficient at collecting the data. So we'll consult with Irene and see where she thinks it goes from here. And this we can compare with other recent studies that have shown, you know, species in macrosamia make these compounds, and it's been shown that they definitely attract the beetles. There have been experiments showing that the beetles go to these specific compounds, and not all the compounds that are produced, but specific ones. So we'll see if those are the same or different in Dioon. Eventually, better understanding of the pollinator and the pollination biology of the plants will help us to conserve these plants, because the plants are completely dependent on these insects for their pollination, right? And so it goes back a little bit to the idea of conserving environments and habitats and ecosystems, not just specific organisms.
So if you're strolling through the cycad walk and an errant weevil lands on your shirt instead of a cycad, don't kill it. We need every weevil we have.